Good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming on to the Hilton Parish Council meeting. I'll try and do the first bit right first tonight. Receive any apologies for absence. Now you'll have seen apologies from Graham and Simon. And as we mentioned last month, those reasons for being not here will be recorded in the minutes. We've also had apologies from Ian Bates this evening. Couldn't be with us.
And Councillor June said that he would be here if he could, but okay. Wasn't 100% sure, so he's obviously not able to.
Right. And then any declarations of interest, anybody?
Yes, I have a pecuniary interest in the clerk's payment.
Nothing for you. Okay. Thank you very much. Got that right this time.
And I suppose it's worth adding that I have a non-pecuniary interest in the general point around speed watches. I'm a speed watch volunteer.
Thank you. Just good, good, good. Okay. So that concludes item one on the agenda. We have comments and observations from members of the public and received reports from county district councillors and from the PCO Phil Davis. Thank you very much for coming this evening. We'll do the comments and observations from the members of public, then we'll invite you to say your bit, and then you don't have to stay for the whole meeting. Okay. So close the parish council meeting and open up the floor to any comments from the public. Andy.
Okay. Regarding agenda item 3.2, A14, it's a perennial one. I really like to understand why the website still hasn't been updated since May. On the 2nd of June at the PC meeting, this issue was raised, and Councillor Baradell said that the working group has plans to update the website. 7th of July at the PC meeting, Councillor Goodridge spoke to Councillor Perez about getting more information on the website, and Councillor Perez had sent HCM information over to the working group, and the website will be updated more regularly. On the PC meeting the 1st of September, there was no mention of the website at all. At the Tuesday the 23rd meeting, which was the open meeting, the village meeting, at the end there, Councillor Bleakey said, we will put the letter to HA with the feedback from this meeting on the PC website. That you would also have the notes, which I believe Councillor Baradell was taking from the meeting, on the board and the website. There were also some photographs taken at that meeting, and I think the intention was to do something with those. Now, you had some excellent materials at that meeting. The exhibition, I thought, was really good. It would be also very good to see those on the website also, where we could all have them, as I think Councillor Goodridge suggested at that meeting. Why hasn't any of this been done? And the website is still...
We'll attend to it, Andy.
Oh, Peter,
we'll
can I just...
Sure the website is updated following the update to the 8th. Tonight, following which you're here, following the meeting from HA, and we will put that to rights.
Can I just ask that my questions are answered during those sessions? Because patently at the last meetings, when questions for myself and other members of the council were asked, you did say they will be covered in the council agenda items, and never were. So effectively, you get them buried, and they don't get answered. So can I ask that the questions are answered during the A4th meeting, not like this whole list here with three or four meetings where nothing has happened from meeting to meeting? That's my request.
If it's relevant, we'll answer it. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments from the member of the public? Can you hear
that? I have another one. Do you want me to go before the police? Can I?
You can, yeah.
Unless there's somebody else on. Yes? Okay. I wrote to the clerk on the 7th of October and didn't get a reply and sent a follow-up on the 31st of October. In that letter to the clerk, I said, Dear Joe, as parish clerk...
Sorry, Andy, yes? That isn't on the agenda.
It's relating to item 5, correspondence.
There's nothing on the agenda that relates to this.
This is relating to correspondence from the public.
There is nothing on this agenda that mentions correspondence from the public. It is about Balfour Beatty.
And yeah, correspondence from the public.
Your comments.
So you're not going to answer correspondence from the public, either via letter or via this meeting?
We have.
Unless it's on the agenda.
Not unless it's on the agenda.
So you're not going to put it on the agenda if I write to you? you'll just bury it again, will you?
We'll choose.
Because this was about the outrageous behaviour of Councillor White at the last meeting, attacking a member of the public when he couldn't defend himself.
The agenda comes out, Andy, as you know, 3 days ahead of a meeting.
Yes.
And if you sent me an email on the 31st
of October... On the 7th of October I sent you an email.
That was a statement rather than...
All right, I had a question in there as well.
An answer.
So are you going to answer the question that was in that letter on the 7th of October?
I'll have a look at your email and I'll reply to your email.
So my request in that... letter was at this meeting.
Andy, so it needs to be.
Well, sorry, the question was quite a clear question in that on the 7th of October. Yes. That I was very aggrieved at the way I was treated at that meeting. And in there was a question. No, and there's a question in there.
Name mentioned in that meeting. And therefore, as Joe said, if you sent her an email on the 31st of October, it will be addressed.
I sent
her
on.
She worked part time. I'm sure she was probably done her hours last week by the time your email came in. And her hours this week start today, now.
Yeah, there was a letter on the 7th of October, that's 3 weeks away.
Didn't beg a reply.
Didn't get a reply.
Didn't beg a
reply. Okay, well, or a suggestion that I suggest that a public apology is forthcoming at the next meeting. Now is the next meeting, that's the question. Is that going to happen?
There is nothing on the agenda, as you can see from the agenda.
That's very selective, I think. So I'd like to make a complaint about the selective agenda writing, not answering parishioners' questions. Okay,
yes.
If that's the way you want to vote.
You can submit a complaint if you feel hard done by.
I do feel hard done by. I think it's outrageous behaviour that a councillor can make statements.
Okay, we'll move on now. Thank you, Andy. Any other members of the public wish to make a comment at this time? I don't know your name.
My name's Roger Furness.
Hello, Roger.
I don't actually live in the village at the moment. I come to represent my mother.
Oh, yeah.
And will the strip of common land that runs from the manor down to Hilton House be covered under 3.3, the green management?
Not specifically, in that the green management was just a quick report on green activities that have been going on this month.
So is it something to be brought up at another meeting then, is it? Or
sorry?
Will it be something I should bring up at another meeting about that?
I think if you put my writing to the clerk what the issue is, and I think then we'll deal with it.
Yeah, because just to outline you just briefly, do we know exactly which is the common, which grass is the common along there? Because we're a little bit worried about edges have been taken up recently, etc. So,
yeah.
I'll write to you.
We do know the boundaries.
Lovely, thank you.
Thank you, Roger. Okay. We'll move on now to PCSOV.
Good evening, everybody. Nice to see everybody.
And Rachel,
just asked to pop along by Supervisor Randy Street just to give a little bit of an update over the past month or so. It would have been a really good month apart from the fact that there have been 4 residential burglaries, 2 at the beginning of October, 2 at the end. 1 property was not a forced entry, 3 others were, but in most cases, but in all cases, jewellery has been the main item to have been taken. I say 2 at the beginning of October, 2 at the end. Incidents, nothing really of note other than there was 1 of poaching beginning of October. When the time the police came out, people had gone. And then the final one was 30th of October, there was a suspicious incident reported of a suspicious man in the village. A male was stopped by the local PCSOs and everything was okay. That's the only incident that's had over the month. With regards to burglaries, the burglary team have got suspects on their radar. It's happening in virtually every village you can think of, and it is sporadic, like it's similar to now, it's very sporadic offending. And the local office also, we're patrolling out here and everywhere else as much as possible. But, go on.
Yeah, I was just going to add some bits to that. So, just about. Say to your parishioners, just follow the basic security advice. You know, if you can get somebody to, if you're going to go away, get somebody to come in, turn lights on, draw curtains, or have lights on timers, it's really, really important. Have a radio on a timer, because if they think somebody's in, chances are they're not going to like break in. But also, just keep an eye out. Just if you see anybody hanging about, it's not just at night times, it's at day times. And it doesn't have to be people in vans, okay? We have this common thing that people who go out burgling are in vans and stuff. They're in cars, they're on foot, they're on bikes. Okay, so if you do see anybody just like hanging around, you know, and just walking up and down alleyways, a lot of burglaries at the moment seem to be happening on the verge of alleyways, or there's high conifer trees and stuff, so they can be hidden. And so they're sort of like, not out the way, but just hidden from general members of the public. So, you know, these kind of houses, they do need to have like good security lights. Also, it might be worth looking on the internet and stuff for sort of like security lights that take photos. They're not expensive, but it might be just worth saying to people that, you know, it's just a SIM card that goes into the camera and they take photos if you can't afford CCTV, but just to follow the basic security advice. But if you can get that across to members, you know, or even do some, you know, just not patrols, but just keep an eye out, that would be great.
Last month we put a little bit in Spectrum up at the top of the Parish Council news about the two burglaries that happened at the beginning. So we'll repeat that in our Spectrum, because that goes to every household in the village.
That's what it needs to. But if you could just say, you know, be extra vigilant if you do see someone hanging around a property, or just, you know, even walking and you don't recognise them, then it's worth just putting a call through and stuff. But just for general basic security advice would be great, because we do try and send out messages and stuff on ECOPS, but it doesn't go to every resident, and you know, you're a good way of making sure that that gets across to everybody, so that'd be great.
And we have a great neighbourhood watch coordinator in Ken, who sent out the neighbourhood watch update following the burglary on the 30th of October.
But it's also, if you've got anything of value, don't put it in the normal place. We say this all the time, you know, chances are when someone gets burgled, they'll go into the bedrooms and they'll look for jewellery boxes in bedside cabinets and stuff. If you've got anything of value, put it away in something unusual, you know, sort of like up in the loft in loads of boxes, you know, so it's not easy to find. You know, you can't do that with common stuff that you use all the time. But stuff in your value, you know, just put up and
be sensible.
Yeah.
Well, it doesn't even have to be something of value, just because something's been passed down through the family, it's worth something to yourself. But that's the thing that obviously they're going for. So that's the sort of thing that we just advise people to try and hide if possible. And just another one of the other properties actually did have sensor lights, and they were pushed up out of the way, so obviously they wouldn't. They only come on once when they first arrived, push them up, and they might be on anymore. But I think also at least one of them was during the daytime as well. So.
Opportunities.
We're just asking residents to be vigilant and to report things to us. And like I said, there's only been one incident because of a suspicious mail, and he turned out to be all okay. But we'd rather get a report than not a report. And the only people who know who is suspicious are the people who are actually in the village, or if we have to be patrolled and we see something that all looks a bit dodgy, we'll just have a chat with that person. Yeah.
But we do need sort of like eyes and ears, because it's very hard to do sort of like in 10 places at once. So we try to come out to the villages, but we stretch other ways as well with this burglaries happening. So.
Yeah.
You're not alone.
Exactly.
I'm afraid.
Is there any pattern to the time of day of those burglaries? Is it spread around?
No, I don't think there is. It's spread around. It's spread around.
Daytime, nighttime.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe again, one of the burglaries over a 2-day period, and that the people have gone away. But in incidents we've had it where someone's gone away an hour later, they'd come home and they'd been burned, or, you know, so that's also clearly an opportunity to see someone go out. You know. And we just those not related, we have had a company going around. I don't think they've been to Hilton as yet, I'm not sure of any incidents. It's called First Angel Home Improvements, knocking on doors saying there was going to be some noise down the road, we're working down the road, or while I'm here, is there any work that you would like us to do? Can I jump to have a look at your windows, that sort of thing, all of your roofs? Oddly enough, they're not actually committing any offences. The only time they'd be committing offences is if they actually did take work on and they didn't go through the proper procedures of allowing for a 14-day cooling off period and that sort of thing. And there's been quite a few incidents reported in St Ives and more recently Hemingford. So they could be coming as well.
I don't think their tactics haven't been so, you know, so nice, but it's all we can say to them is, you know, if you go to around business, you know, please be mindful what you say and stuff like that.
Your doorstep.
Yeah.
Are we allowed to name them?
Pardon?
In our...
Yeah, probably best not to. Well, I've got no problems with you saying that to you. That is the name of the future family.
Yeah.
Who I'm talking to, that's who they're from. The trading standards have been made aware, because obviously what they're doing wouldn't fall into the offensive. Now we're regarding trading standards, it's not really an appropriate way of doing business. Yeah. So they are aware.
Can I just ask a supplementary question? And that is that my understanding is that Anglia Home Improvements dropped one because the door they knocked on was in fact a neighbourhood watch coordinator. And he stood his ground and wouldn't even let them down his drive. What he then said was, leave my property. And the chap carried on talking, and he asked him again, are you refusing to leave my property? And the fellow eventually walked away. It was our understanding that if someone is asked to leave your property and doesn't leave your property, then we can call for you chaps.
Yeah, that's fine. Like I
Whereas
said.
The original business of cold calling, and perhaps bogus cold calling, is strictly a trading standards matter.
Like you said, their tactics haven't been best received by members of the public. And, you know, this is what we will go out and we will see to them and we will tell them about it. But they're not committing any offences. They're very careful, you know, and it's not orthodox practice what they're doing. But
now, one of the other questions that has been, well, one of the other issues that has been mentioned is no cold calling surveillance. Now, once again, that's trading standards, I think. But do they look to yourselves for the experience in the neighbourhood?
They sometimes do. I mean, the last one I dealt with was in Blundisham.
That was done through HTC, wasn't it?
Because the trading standards blow those up on the plates as well.
Could I come to you separately and ask for advice on that, and then we can spread that around when we consider the possibility of requesting you?
The only thing is, because you can't stop people from going to houses, it is usually where there are people are vulnerable.
Yeah.
So if they've got a road safety, most people are vulnerable, then trading standards and HDC and us would probably say,
We can't just put it down in
streams
and stuff. And it tends to be around like areas where there's a high number of bungalows where you've got quite a lot. Elderly residents, and that tends to be the areas that they will put up these signs.
Good.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
But here's your time. Yeah,
you're welcome.
Brilliant. Your niece, Hoscott. Hoscott, Seacott?
No.
No?
I'll get in touch with you through email.
Yeah, okay.
If you want to ask Joe can forward you a lot too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much indeed. We will ask you if you'd like to come to each of our parish council meetings.
Each of them?
Well, yeah, they usually have them first.
Yeah, I have the question there.
Because it was something that came up at our last meeting that a few years ago, there was always representation.
Yeah, we can't commit to everyone. So we'll try
and
make
what
it
said
regular.
When somebody can.
Well, obviously, if you measure the size of the area we've got in our parishes, it would be quite.
Yes.
To be able to cover that, it's only five PCSOs.
But if it's needed, like you do want, you've got quite a few questions that you needed answering. If we're unable to attend, please email us, and we can maybe answer some questions, which then you can answer on our behalf in the meeting. So, you know, you're quite welcome to ask any questions. Okay. And if you can't get a hold of me, just rachel.anderson at the same email address.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Whilst you're welcome,
Helen?
Just hang on, that's fine. It's what you think.
We're not allowed to take rides, I'm afraid.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good
thank you. Good evening. Thank you.
And the last part under reports was. email received from Ian, just to let us know that the Cambridge County Council budget is now in the public domain, and there's highlights he's put in there, there's a possible introduction of a £1 parking charge at the Park and Ride site in St Ives, and that doing of street lighting to 40%, and in residential areas street lights will be switched off between the hours of 12 to 6 a.m. Ian's part. So we'll close the public session and reopen the parish council meeting now. And item two on the agenda is to approve the minutes of the previous meeting of the parish council held on the 6th of October, which you've all had a copy of. Any amendments to? Happy with?
Yep.
Would somebody like to propose accepting them?
I'll propose, yeah.
Thank you. Steve?
In a second.
Yeah. All those in favour? Thanks. I'll make sure those aren't sign up for you. Thank you. So we have item three, which is matters arising or carried forward from the last meeting for discussion and decision, fireworks. So firstly, on fireworks, before I hand it over, I'd like to say thank you very much to everybody for putting their hands in on Saturday, and the organisation. Thank you, Stephen and Kieran, for lighting the bonfire, and Doreen and Ian and Willie for being on the gate, just those parked at the end of the round, and for coming down during the day and for setting up. If I've missed you, anybody out, I do apologise, but thank you all very much.
Simon was also on the gate.
Of course, Simon was on the gate as well, and I think he brought the float.
And he organised the float and the
bucket. So it's very good. And although it's a quiet morning when I did the 2 hours on the bonfire, people coming down, the bonfire was certainly big enough. And went well, and I thought the fireworks were fantastic.
Good construction.
I think we want to also thank
the firework team. And we need to thank them a letter.
And Judy Walt, who volunteered to be our first aider. And Annette, who provided a whole load of pallets from somewhere.
Excellent.
Where we got those from.
Yeah, that was good. Well, Kevin, Judy. And of course, feast week for their illuminated store.
I'd like to ask how the advert got into the Hunts Post that we were having a bonfire, because it was certainly noticeable that a lot of outsiders were coming, and there were travellers arriving as well, and there was trouble on the gate when we arrived, unfortunately. She had obviously driven onto the wilderness while it was being set up, planning to set up her stall, and then she ended up along Rags Row, blocking the entrance to the Grange.
Did she?
Yes.
Don't know how the
entrance
was driven.
No.
Yeah, certainly wasn't.
We're in a catch-22 because it was good that we had outsiders, because that boosted our funds. But if we're going down the route of wanting it to be a little village event next year, free to our friends and neighbours, we don't want that to happen again.
Did you see it in the paper?
Yes, I did. I was most surprised to see
it. When you say an ad, was it?
It was just a little sentence with, along with other fireworks. I just happened to see it. It wasn't an ad,
perhaps some news.
It picked it up from somewhere.
That's the person picks up. Can you say that it's a matter for Green Working Group, but we need to think about the ash again?
Absolutely, that was on my list.
I was going to say, why it's hot, but it's not. But when it's cool, so to speak.
So I don't know. I think it must have been a journal that picked up.
You must have a staffer that goes around bulletin boards and things like that.
There's the village board in there.
Yeah, we did all the flyers and notice boards and stuff.
I mean, the first person that came through the gate said, "Oh, where do we go? We're from Offord Clooney." I thought, oh, gosh.
It was a nice evening, though, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That
was
reflected in the
taking.
Yes,
the good news.
Yeah. Well, it's almost good news.
Almost good news. Actually, well, we bought up the ashes. You want to set a date next Sunday?
Find what's not on right. Sunday. Weekend after.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I'll put an email out.
Yeah. please do. Question. Can I ask a question whether it's ash and a log?
It's just ash.
That log burnt.
It was all burning up, yeah.
Incredible.
Yes, there was some stuff on, for those that don't know, some stuff on above where they came out of the wear from underwater. They sat there all evening without even getting charred. It just sat in the middle of this blaze and didn't.
We kept putting it on top of all the burning shots. So it's that long.
Did go in the end.
Excellent. Good. It was incredible that it just wouldn't be affected by it. All this blazing heat around it, and it just wouldn't do it. So it's fireworks taking.
Was 1,613.55.
Yes.
I have no idea how we got 55.
I may have the answer.
Well, I did throw a 20p in.
You.
I think a lot of my
I believe Heidi also came in some change. Yeah. She came down and she said, because you know, so, well, I might be responsible for that. So, excellent.
So, and also, people were saying, we'll keep the change.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that shows that if we're leading to donation buckets next year, that would be nice.
Yeah. So it's very good. Excellent turnout, and obviously the weather helped a lot. Such a nice day and evening. So it was fantastic. So the question will be for the what we're going to do next year, and taking forward the proposal that we had out with regards to the fireworks, yeah? And whether it's appropriate to decide anything tonight on future firework decisions, or whether we cogitate over next month.
I'm pretty sure the next month will be the right time to do it. Well, everyone's read that note that we sent around, but might be worth going out and doing it next month.
I thought so.
It's probably worth having a chat with the firework crew to see if we do scale it down and adjust the budget accordingly. Yeah. What kind of display are we looking at? Half as long or same duration but not as varied. You know, that's
well, it was 12 or 13 minutes, wasn't it?
Yeah, so
well, it was fantastic.
It will be around half that length.
Yeah.
Well, it's difficult to get a feeling for what level of donation. Some friends of ours went to one up in Newcastle, and that's purely funded on donation, and they do very, very well. They run it as a charitable event, so once costs are covered, the rest goes to charity. And people just throw in £10 as they come in. So it covers all the costs very easily. So that, it may be that model.
The problem, of course, is in the first year. To get around the problem of committing the money up front, or too much money up front, and taking that risk, you're not going to know. I mean, if we give money to charity, it doesn't help us, but if you roll any excess forward to the following year, and we can get in a rhythm where we've got something carried forward from the previous year.
Are we allowed to give money to charity?
Certainly. No, why not? Do you think not?
Well, because you'd have to advertise. Would you advertise that then the money's going to say MenCap or something? You know, this is purely to go to MenCap. You know,
no, well, it would be only what's the cost of charity.
You can't. You can't just give people's money to charity if they haven't really given. They might not want to give to MenCap, they might want to give to Help for Heroes, but that's whether, you know, there are rules.
If that's the model to follow, then you might want to choose a selection of charities. Charities that
I think we need to find out what you do about charity in that respect.
Yeah, you might have a look.
There are rules.
Into the discussion.
Do you think it's worth the work group reconvening again before next meeting, just to talk some of these issues through?
Yeah, to give a little presentation to us. Would be quite nice, wouldn't it? Yeah, but worthwhile, wouldn't it? You might say, scale back the cost of the fireworks to 300 quid.
We go away and have a chat, keep and away and think about it.
Yeah. That might be an option, don't know. But I know where document is going. So we'll look forward to that.
You can check Joe find out about the charity.
Yeah. Really.
Anything else on fireworks? But once again, just thanks to everybody for all their effort in putting, making it so good. 3.2, A14, update following meeting with highways agency. So, following on from our open evening and the agreement of the highways agency to meet subsequent to that, we were able to meet with the highways agency. We produced a list of items that we wished to discuss with them. They had a list of answers, and basically their feeling, I guess the feeling you got from the meeting was that the development centre will go in autumn, so one assumes it is on the verge of being submitted. When it's received by the planning inspectorate, they will read it. They have a short window of 3 or 4 days to go through all the documentation before they post it on their website, on the planning inspectorate's website, at which point it is likely that the period for individuals to register as an interested party, or individuals or of course the parish council, will be open, and that could be a 28-day period, it could be a 2-week period, but we don't know. The highways agency have or are going to send us through some more details with regards to the process. So as a group we have got a flyer ready, almost, to be able to run off and distribute to every household as soon as the order has been, we're aware that the thing has been submitted and that that period is going to be open. And the proposal was that we would have a meeting at that point to highlight to the parishioners what the next stage is in the planning process. The question of the route was covered by the agency by saying that it had been consulted on many times, had obviously been challenged and had been reconsulted, and although the route, the final route, won't be set in stone until that order has been placed, you can read between the lines as to where it's going, likely going to be.
See the diggers.
They wanted to dismiss the idea that because the diggers were there, that was where the route was going to be, because the route hasn't been finalised yet. There will, and like I say, there will be that limited period of time when individuals can register as interested parties. They listened to us, they talked about bunding and said that the bunding would be 2 metres above the road height level, although in the minutes of the meeting, which we're going to ask to be clarified, it says that, it doesn't say that. It says that it'll be 2 metres above.
It's 2 metres high.
2 metres high, yeah. So we ask them to clarify, because at the meeting they did say it'd be 2 metres above the road level. They talked that planting wasn't the bottom of the agenda, these things, so that if there was an overspend on the road, planting would be knocked down. They said that's an urban myth. Planting is very much part of the whole project, and will be taken, is part of their big submission that they'll be putting into the planning inspectorate. The actual size of documentation that will come out will be enormous when it's issued, and we will have a shortest period of time to read, look and make recommendations. But the thrust of the group will be to ensure that as much mitigation can be put in place for Hilton as possible. we talked about the possibility of HGV ban permanent through the village, and they were going to mention this to CCC, Cambridgeshire County Council, and we have got, there was a meeting last week, I think they were due to meet with them, so we were asking them what the outcome of that meeting was, and we would, as a group, were going to follow that up in an approach to the Cambridgeshire County Council and to Huntingdon District Council. So that's the update following the meeting with the Highways Agency. Anything you'd like to add?
Well, I think remember you were going to approach the our MP and whoever else we persuade to follow up on work on letters they've already sent and to try and reinforce that. And I think the other specific on the village was picked up from our exhibition meeting. A number of people were saying, let's make the village an unpleasant place to drive through. My words, not theirs. And hence the whole traffic calming, etc. So we want to put together a proposition that makes it less likely that people will want to drive through.
Yes, because there was the they had some outline modelling which they felt that the route running through the village wouldn't increase quality of the building of the new road, which we challenged quite hard on, and will continue to challenge hard on. So, with that now updated to the Parish Council, we can put an update on the website, which, yes, we acknowledged at our last meeting we have not been good at updating the website.
Well, that's very generous of you. Let's make some apologies to one and all that I missed correspondence and should put a bit more time in there. So, that's right. It's taken longer than the team, but really it's down to me. So.
We will strive to make a vast improvement in that, especially as the next stage of this process comes ever closer.
Yes.
Yeah. Because that's going to, that's in, the next important step is for people who wish to register as interested parties when the planning submission has been lodged and is open to that part becomes open, and we need to support, be able to provide information and support parishioners to register and give some ideas as to what they might like to say and talk about. So, anything else on the 814?
When you talk about rat running and traffic calming measures to the village to make it not an attractive rat run, was there any suggestion that there might be a pot of money in this project for the traffic calming measures, special cases, or those that have lost out?
No.
But they did say they'd support any plot we had for traffic.
Although it sounds from what you said that they weren't acknowledging that there would be a problem increasing so that's the first obstacle.
Yes, and that's where the letters to our representatives was going to go, isn't it? So it was a good letter in 2000.
Yeah, we were endeavour to we were going to work through him. That was, we thought that was the best way of getting a similar kind of letter, which had both Ian's signature and Jonathan Lockwood's, pushing for a better deal for Hilton. And if we can achieve that in the coming weeks, I think that'll put us in quite a good position.
Yeah.
Just going back to your pot of money thing. One of the very first meetings, there was some discussion of legacy funding for things like cycleways and on costs to help mitigate. We in your meeting, I was there.
The legacy item that they mentioned was the borrow pits, and that they will be talking about what the use of those borrow pits will be post A14 construction, because they were saying that the material that they would extract from those borrow pits will be, the borrow pits would be exhausted on completion of the building of the pit, so there'll be no future use of them because of the shale or something that's about that deep in there. So the environmental study for the April King isn't available yet, but will be part of the submission. So we couldn't get answers on that side of things. Those will only be available when the thing has been submitted. They did say that there would not be any future public consultation on the project by Highways, but if and when the project were approved, there would be some advisory meetings held on the grounds of what implications there were for construction and construction traffic and times of construction. So, you know, what times during the day that might happen and occur. But that would be all closer to the time that construction would commence.
Would it be fair to say after your meeting that the focus is changing slightly away from route change to building a vestibule?
Yeah, the implications were that there wasn't going to be a route change. Although it hadn't been finalised, what you saw was going to be it, really. And they are continually updating and modifying the project, taking into account the comments they had following the consultation period and what comes in from environmental study, which, as I say, you couldn't get information on because it isn't finalised. So, not great, but we will continue as a parish council to press for mitigation as much as possible in the village coaching.
What's the latest as in most recently updated proposed start date for construction?
It's 2016, it's still the
whether it's January or December, or has that changed? Do we know?
I'm not aware that it's changed, so whatever was in the original plot seems to be the case.
Because it was originally 2016, wasn't it, when they consulted about a year ago. And then it all got pushed back and...
But that, so it's still...
So we've at least 9 months must have expired from the original schedule that they weren't originally planning. So I don't know whether that's had impacting the start date or whether they're just going to squeeze everything into...
I think squeeze it in is the answer. The submission is detailed as being autumn. And you might consider November as being post-autumn. I suppose December doesn't start until the 21st. Winter doesn't start until the 21st of December. But given the comments made, that submission is likely to be made. And it's this new fast-track plan thing, which means that there doesn't have to be a public inquiry. The planning inspector can call on individuals to make representations on the case if he deems that the Highways Agency haven't answered that in their submission.
I think that's a very interesting point, because one of the observations that we made was that the Highways Agency is being very careful to come to meetings and consult, and that's the buzz around that, because some of us certainly felt that it's more of a tick box exercise, so we can say, oh yes,
we
consulted these people on that, so it's fine now. Regardless of almost of the answer, that's been a little bit facetious, but Heather be flavour of that.
So we will.
We'll be optimistic.
No. We'll continue to do so. We will continue to talk to Highways. And then when it goes to planning inspectorate, that is that's the body to be communicated with, is what they're saying, isn't it?
Yeah.
Once it goes to. Once it's submitted, your route of correspondence becomes the planning inspectorate rather than the Highways Agency. Mm-hmm. So, there we are. Any other comments? We will do as we have said with regards to beating ourselves up and giving better updates on the website. Item 3.3, which is greener management open spaces, trees, ditches, and other aspects. Kira, I think.
Firstly, thanks to John Carter and Duncan Michael for the great job they did on the wear. They also cleared the outflow of Reeves Ditch. So that's great. I believe Duncan procured a brand new pair of chest waders to do this job. So what he was paid probably didn't quite cover that, but that shows commitment. While we're talking about ditches, just a heads up for the next month's agenda. We need to think about ditch clearing for January. So go on the agenda, I'll forward the numbers in advance. Tree work. Ian Stott and I have walked around the green with three tree surgeons, and we've resulted in three quotes. As I mentioned on an email I sent out earlier, we need to protect their commercial
identity.
I think at this point. So what I've done is the sheet everybody's got. We've got vendor 1, 2, and 3. Hopefully that's pretty self-explanatory. Ian and I have had a good chat about this and talked about the various merits of each vendor. We were extremely impressed by vendor number 2, and was pleasantly surprised when the quote came in. So on that basis, we could, but for £40, deal with all of priority A and priority B trees and items on the list within this budget period.
And that would include the fallen willow over the pond, of course, which is great. Yeah. That would be really good.
It is good, this, because last year we just did the priority A for safety reasons. Mm. And there's quite a lot of damage on trees which really should be looked after to save the tree from disease. And it means we can do a little bit of that kind of work, which is good to safeguard the stock of trees we have. So I guess that's the issue to vote on. Mm-hmm. If you're happy with the schedule of work and the pricing, then Ian, our tree warden's happy.
And the timing for the activity suits. Sorry.
The timing of the activity in the next 6 to 8 weeks.
Do we know how it's going to do the falling tree across the...
Yes,
that interests me, that one.
We do. I mean, there's various schemes were suggested from each vendor. Vendor number 2 has got a JCB teleporter, which will lift it up and you can then deal with it on the bank.
Yeah.
So nice and safe, nice and easy, can work from the street off the main road. Mm-hmm.
And then who did the three vendors plan to do with the waste materials and all the tree activity?
All quotes include cutting the logs into manageable barrow sizes and stacking by the site for parishioners to take.
And the rest gets shredded.
The rest gets taken away and shredded. In fact, if we go for vendor 2, it will finish up in its power station, I guess. Mm-hmm. Or was it Ely Power Station? One of the two, anyway. He sells it on to make electricity.
Feeling our lights are being powered by some sort of obscure way.
Has anybody got any questions regarding
the tree? I propose that we agree to cover priority A and B trees in line with vendor 2's proposals. All those in favour? Thank you very much. So, we need a letter from Joe to authorise the work. Yeah. So, if you don't mind, Joe. Mm-hmm. And then we can. So, that's treatment. Ditches, you've mentioned there'll be something coming up.
For the next month, yes.
Yeah. They lit a fire in front of
No,
not trying to burn it down, but just actually lighting a fire on the green. So I think that's a young children, please don't. I'll ask the person concerned for a little bit more detail.
Seems
a
funny thing to do, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Funny place to do it.
Mm. Yeah, because quite happens, hasn't it? Yeah. Snuck away something to... I think not worth saying, apart from the obvious, yes, you know, there's a danger to your own health, safety. If any criminal damage is coming from this activity, we will seek to prosecute them.
Don't be rude.
Consequences.
Of course, in the policy, I think saying something like camping and lighting fires. So
there is,
We'll put something in play. Any other updates?
No.
Thank you very much. Well, any questions on the green management, ladies and gentlemen? Yeah, I think Kieran was about to
I just, the other thing I put in here was the ash path, which we'll deal with.
Yeah.
I'll put some dates out. And,
cleared so it doesn't build up.
Yes.
Send out some dates.
So there's been talking about the wilderness stuff. I don't know if Sharon and her team were responsible for clearing the wilderness, because by the time we got down there, there was... I picked up two bits of tissue.
Yes,
thank you, that was really noted.
Yeah. Thank you, Sharon.
Thank you.
I trust you found no glass whilst you were doing it. No glass at all, good. I'm pleased to hear it. Thank you. And then, so that's that. And so 3.4 is emergency plan, which I'm just reading here. So this was the emergency flood plan that we had brought up at the last meeting, and I'm not sure if you will have the opportunity to read through. I read through it and have a couple of suggestions.
I'm just wondering whether it's just me on my own, whether we need to close the meeting in case I need to call on Ken.
Well, I wondered if maybe it would be best. I just think if I... There's only... points are very cool. And then if we need to, we could have a little meeting up between times just to finalise the document and get it sorted out. I thought it was good. It's obviously very easy to read and points out what should be done. There was one thing was you've got the Gov website. It would be useful to have the address of that gov.uk website in the document, maybe. But my main, the only one, the real one was, you've got...
Is this on, sorry, on the flood plan or the emergency plan?
I've got it on page... No, that page 6 had said something about something in Annex A, and I just haven't got Annex A. That was a question, that was on page 3, first paragraph. It says, guidance on preparing for a flood or the risk of flooding is published on the gov.uk website. I just wanted to say www.gov.uk.
So if you click on it,
it doesn't do that.
Mr. Chairman, may I make one comment on this? When we had the flood in 2001, there wouldn't have been a flood if the grid from the that went underneath the underneath Dooley's driveway, that grid in the end of the pond hadn't have been there. I lifted that out and within 2 hours the village was clear. Now these grids that are on at the moment, you can't move.
The one at the end of Tide Go?
One on the end of Gravel Way, and also the one going underneath the culvert there. You can't move them. So if they get blocked, then you are going to get a flood, because they're bolted on. Yeah. Where the other one, I just lifted it out and it was just opening a bar. Within 2 hours the village was clear.
Yeah, we do have the villagers that live near to where the grills are. They are aware of that they can get blocked up and they're very good at keeping
With respect, that isn't going to help.
I know what you're
saying. If there's enough water coming through down past Kisby's hut and all the way down there through those drains, then you are going to get blockage there and people won't get to it quick enough. You can't get those grids off. If those grids were removable, you can solve your problem immediately.
Would the grids put on our rewards?
We'll have a look at that. My only other comment really was on your contact telephone numbers. Then that I wondered whether it would be advisable to have the emergency officer first, rather than this was on the draft. There may be a further draft, mightn't there?
No, this is
because I've got it, and it's down here. Yeah.
You're on the flood plan or the emergency plan thing?
Yeah, I've got.
On the flood plan.
It's the only one I've got. It's the only one that printed when I pressed print. Which is Hilton flood plan.
Right.
Sorry. That was the only thing that printed off when I pressed print. I'll have a look at the other one. I'll try and find the other one. But it was the list of contacts here, whether or not the emergency officer should come to the top. And I wondered whether it would be useful to have a name in there, and also if you have an alternative, Dorian, because if you were away,
there is a deputy.
On page 10.
Oh yeah, deputy.
Can you see?
EO. Page. Mine printed to page 9.
Ah.
What is?
That's
the one.
It printed seem to be.
No, it printed stuff afterwards and everything, but it just printed. It changes. Very sorry, I'll have to have a look. Look at that. Yeah.
Need some oil.
Yeah, obviously need some red ink. I'll have a look. I'll come back to you. But if we could meet up, then that'd be useful.
And the flood plan has been sent to the environment officer in County Council, but she sent apologies to say that she has been away, and she's also been dealing with people's houses that are flooded in other parts of the area, so she's not been out to look at it yet.
I just wondered if names in there might be a nice touch as well. So when people knew who they were phoning, if they had to phone.
Right.
But that might be in a latter page, obviously.
In respect of Hilton or...?
Yeah, in respect of Hilton. Yeah.
Because I think that's in the emergency plan.
Which doesn't appear to have.
Yes. No, it's all here in the emergency plan.
On page 5.
On page 5.
Yeah. I will read that then, because obviously that's a bit of a faux pas, sorry. But that's all it's printed on. Yeah. Anyway, we'll have a look at that.
Quite a lot of the coordination seems to be handled initially in floodplain, at least, by the emergency officer. There is a deputy named, but I just wondered if there was some kind of procedure to make sure that there was at least one person in charge in the village all the time. Otherwise.
If I'm going away on a holiday, then I will let Ken know that I am, but I'm obviously not going to let him know every time I disappear from the village or vice versa. Andy Bush and Ian Stott are on board as well. And I think what we're hoping for in the not too distant future is that we're going to be making contact with neighbours who are on the periphery of, say, the four corners of the village, and bring them on board to say, well, can you keep your eyes and ears open? And if you see any, I mean, we are really talking flooding here, aren't we, for our village, that you will contact us we can deal with it.
Yeah. There is a telephone cascade list for the emergency as well.
Yes.
So that does cover that.
So that's what it is.
Yeah. Well, and you're waiting to hear back from the environment officer to make sure something there stands as well. Yeah. And then we can look to draft it in, can't we?
Yeah.
Accept it as a policy.
And I think also we'd like to get it on the website when it's finalised. Not too much information. We just want people generally to just be alert.
But obviously have the typical link.
I mean, a good example that it has worked once was the tree across the pond, you see. Kieran called me because someone had called him. I was able to call people and we managed to get the emergency people there just before the tree fell across the road during rush hour. That it did work, but that was really not because of this plan, it was because people were just keeping their eyes and ears open.
So we want a little
bit of common sense,
article, don't we? Just saying that Hilton has now got
it's got to be so that people can just read it.
There needs to be a
précis of what we've said.
With two or three key contact details.
With reference to the plan can be found within the policies and documents.
But in principle, have you all read it and all sort of looked at it? Thanks to Ken and Andy and Ian for coming with me to it.
No, it's brilliant. Obviously, I'm failing on not quite getting to the end of it, but we'll have.
It's nice and comprehensive in terms of the role description, so it's good to hear what's expected of the officer in charge of it.
Yes.
So just to say, John's left the meeting now, but if John's right about his grids, as he calls them,
that's
extremely worrying statement.
The grids are there for a reason, though.
Of course they are.
That's right, we need to know if they can be sluiceable.
But then, if they do get locked at the last minute in a flood, then they may be fine at 6 o'clock one evening and then
I think at 9 o'clock one evening. And I think the flood was caused by a blockage.
Yes.
Against the grid.
You know, I don't think the flood in the village would have been as bad if that particular grid hadn't blocked.
It's effectively like a sluice gate if it gets partly blocked, doesn't it? It needs to be ideally raised partly or entirely.
If you raise the grid, the debris go into the culvert block.
Probably wash it through.
Ian Stott is
off somewhere.
Ian Stott.
Yes,
he's
well, no, we've discussed. We've discussed it.
I wondered if the grids had gone on at the time when the parish came, at the time of the flood.
Whether they weren't on after the flood.
They were not after it. I thought they'd gone on after.
Organised immediately after.
Yeah. Thank you, Peter. Yeah, so we need to look
by the district council, I believe.
Because
as a parish, 15 years ago, and I'm too old to remember.
We haven't.
Right.
There were rooms.
We'll come back to the...
They're less serviceable than these.
Thank you very much. We'll go forward on that basis, that we will... I'll find page 10. Just have a read through, and then I'll contact Doreen and Ken just to talk about where we are with it, because I think we're just... it'll be a case of when the Environment Agency have agreed it, that it's fine, we'll get it back in and accepted and published. And thank you very much for your interest on that. Very much appreciated. So that will close that little bit of open meeting, and we'll go back to the agenda. Speed watch. Update after contacting the customer email. I understand just who you'd like to. Did you still want to?
Yes.
Okay.
I think firstly, to set the scene, it's worth recognising the debt of gratitude to all the school board coordinators and volunteers who, for the past several years, have manned their posts and tried within the guidelines to make a difference to speeding for our village. So that's a very laudable pursuit. What's fundamentally changed, and what will be the question before the council at the end of my little summary, is that the Cambridge Constabulary has moved away from a previous position or strategy of capturing speeding and educating or re-educating speeding activity by the distribution of a letter. And if those letters became many, then an actual visit to a person's home by an officer would educate them, re-educate them, and encourage people slowing down. Now, if you can look at the data that's been captured, one or two sort of simplistic ways, there are less repeat offenders on the data, on the people that are caught going through the Hilton. Is that because the letters are doing their job? Is it because they're just not speeding at the time that Speedwatch is there, or other reasons? You can either look at the glass is half full and it's not contributing to it, or actually it's doing what it says on the tin and is educating people to slow down. However, that said, the Cambridge Constabulary now wants to deter rather than, so prevention is better than cure. So rather than catch people speeding and then generate letters, and letters will still be generated, a large number of letters, it's about being more visible on the side of the road, so the drivers can see there's a speed watch session taking place, and will then therefore slow down much more early and actually speed in the first place. That's not to say that the speed watch activities at the moment is covert. It's not as if the teams are hiding around corners and pouncing at the moment of speeding, but it's a step towards even more visibility, shall we say. So the fundamental question for the council is whether we support the current Speedwatch teams and guidelines, which effectively want to carry on as it was and capturing the speeders, educate them through the letters, and then by supporting them we sign up to putting pressure back on either the Minister of Justice or the Prime Minister Ginobili, so on and so forth, to say no, we believe this is the right way to help control speed in our village, and we're behind the current speed watch initiative as it stands. Or we say thanks very much for helping, but at the moment we've decided as a council we believe that the Cambridge Constabulary is correct, and that approach of deterring, being more visible, and relying less on the letters to re-educate is the way to go. And if that is the case, then we may well have to find a new body of volunteers, or some of the existing volunteers may wish to throw in with these new guidelines and hope that perhaps when the administration comes in, when the chief constable, that the strategy will change once again back to the previous strategy. So I think that's pretty much in summary that you're really asking the question of, do you want to deter, or do you want to catch and educate through the issue of letters?
I read the email, but one more question I've got for you immediately, which is there appears to be a total breakdown in the relationship between the constabulary and our Speedwatch coordinator. A complete breakdown. Yes. How does that affect things going forward in terms of those two options you presented? In other words, I suppose my question is, should the council decide to carry on as it was, Housepeople team carry on as they were, what does that actually mean in terms of support from constabulary, funding, equipment?
Well, the constabulary will only provide the equipment and the support, as I understand it, if the Speedwatch coordinators and volunteers sign up to their new guidelines. Mm-hmm. So if the current volunteers and coordinators want to be part of a scheme, even if they fundamentally disagree with the practice, but hope to perhaps change and influence through time, then they would have to sign up to that. And then they'd get the training, the training would be assessing the lay of the land and the equipment.
And if they didn't?
If they didn't, then...
You would pay for the equipment?
It's not a question of pay. You'd have to find at least two volunteers. You have to have two for a session. So the village, not necessarily the parish council, the village would have to find two volunteers who would need to be trained, and then they would receive the equipment and or go through whoever the new coordinator is and get support from the constabulary that way.
Just to miss my point. If we go with the constabulary's new approach, yeah. I understand exactly what you just said.
Yeah.
I think you said in your opening speech that we need to make a decision about whether to do that,
yeah,
or to go, actually, no, we like the way we did it before, and that's what we want to do.
Yeah. Then can we?
Yeah. Would there still be a service?
How could we continue to do that?
Not if it's current existing guys that wouldn't know, as I understand it. That is the same.
So then we'd be lobbying, basically.
Correct, yeah.
To get the chief constable view.
Mm-hmm. Changed, yeah.
And Stanbury's view changed.
Yeah.
Not a lot of progress seems to be made on that based on the emails that were circulated to the council.
No.
Of late, is that fair?
That's fair.
But there's lots of progress going on at the moment. You've taken a number of inputs from the floor. It seems to be very selective again in the way that you're rejecting some and others.
Don't need to take one at this point. Thank you. The line.
Just tell them about the current situation with the new guidelines.
What do the volunteers think? I mean, you must have spoken to them. Are they happy to move on with the new way? Personally, I'd rather see the speed watch in our village, because once they're gone, then...
But surely support the constabulary, it's going nowhere.
Or the equipment.
So we're sort of being blackmailed to do one thing or...
Well, I mean, I suppose it's like anything. I mean, I wouldn't use that term particularly. I would just say that there has been a strategy change from the constabulary, whereas before they supported with obviously administrative effort and physical manpower to go down the speed watch and watch the speed, capture them speeding, and educate by letters, and now there's been a change. And that's not supported by the majority of the current coordinators and Speedwatch volunteers. They believe very strongly it is about catching them, and their stats would show that it's making a difference if you believe that those letters and no other factors whatsoever are causing the reduction in speed, or repeat offenders, just say.
Can I just ask you, the coordinators and the volunteers, are we talking a large number of people here across a number of villages?
It's the outline.
That's a general
Island district, yeah.
It's 70 volunteers across 23 villages.
Yeah. 70 volunteers across
23 villages. And there are new guidelines, and there have been new guidelines submitted to the Chief Constable this week. There's a compromise set of guidelines between those at the...
But my point was, if the police won't support the old plot, then my suspicion is, like most other public sector bodies, they haven't got the money, they haven't got the people power, they haven't got the admin power. So even they, I have no idea, but I could see a case where they might want to keep it as it is, but they simply can't. So, and I don't know the answer to that, but it just seems, if you see what's happening across all the councils in terms of reduced budgets, the police will be no different.
It's a fair point, and there is a finite budget for the number of letters that are issued.
Mm-hmm.
And due to the success of this particular Speedwatch group and coordinators, that has taken up a large amount of that budget. Part of the thrust of constabulary is to say, well, we only have a finite pot, we need to reduce how many letters we give to your coordinating hub. And of course, that's caused frustration as well, because a lot of volunteers will say, well, I'm giving up 2 hours plus of my time, whatever. If I can only really catch and try and educate the first 50 cars, after that, you will not issue any letters, then of course there's
no point staying.
No point staying.
Yeah. And that was a situation that arose 6-9 months ago, wasn't it? The rationing of the letters.
Correct, yeah, yeah.
When you're talking about it.
Yeah, yeah.
So just to be specific, in this village, do you know whether any of the Speedwatch volunteers that are currently engaged would continue if the future was Cambridgeshire's village? Would we have a Speedwatch team left, or would we be left without one?
Well, I don't know the definitive answer, but the last lot of correspondence I looked at, there's almost a get-out clause, for a better expression, that it really is, and to use a term in the correspondence, the only game in town is to use the guidelines submitted by the Cambridge Constabulary, and that they don't accept the revised guidelines that have been put forward by our coordinator. Then if that is the only game in town, they may choose to say, well, look, I'd rather be part of something that's helping of a fashion and try and change from within, and hope that then once again the wheel turns and you, Chief Constable, comes in place, or whomever, or Precious Walk to their Minister of Justice, and suddenly 6 months from now they change back.
Can I suggest that you have a word with Ian, because he was in at this right at the very beginning, and he knows the whole history of everything, and he has been expressing concerns to me about the complete breakdown of what's happening. He's quite worried about it, or concerned, not worried, he's concerned about this complete breakdown, and he said things are happening that shouldn't be happening, and what's being said isn't right. So if you want to go and have a talk with him and find out the history and how things are, you just need to phone him up. Because I think there's a lot of discussion here, and we could probably go on for quite a long time, talk. But he knows right from the word go when it was set up.
It's a fair point, but even if you park the emotion and whether personalities have clashed or not, as may have been the case, it's still, I think, a pretty basic fundamental question. Do you either throw in without as it is and say, look, I really don't think there's much value to just trying to stand there in a high-vis jacket, give people a quarter of a mile to see you standing there, and of course they'll slow down, but it's not really teaching them anything. Or do you believe that actually the current system, where you're not quite so visible, but you're certainly not covert, is more
effective?
But
our Speedwatch people are visible. We quite often wave to Andy on the side of the road.
Yeah,
but sitting there in clear view of everybody.
Well, that's why I use those words very carefully. I'm not suggesting that the activity before has been covert in the sense that they're hiding behind a bush, because I've been part of it.
Sorry, I wish they could
was the word
in
bush
in that
respect. We're hiding behind Andy. What I'm suggesting, we're uptaking part in these sessions, and we're not, by any stretch of the imagination, hiding behind areas inappropriately. But the fundamental strategy change as well is about making that group even more visible than they currently are, to act as a deterrent.
It may well be that Anne's point is spot on, that this is perhaps driven by necessity rather than by strategy.
Yeah.
But equally, does anyone involved in that you work with and you're involved in this project with know that the greater visibility strategy doesn't deliver results? In other words, it's everyone's gut feeling, like what you're telling me. Everyone thinks that it's better done the way it has been done. But I'm sure someone could pop some evidence, a bit like speed cameras, which were always placed in very visible locations in order to get people to slow down.
Yeah.
And I know a camera's there the whole time and the Speedwatch team isn't, which is one of them. Key differences.
Yeah.
But is there any evidence? Have any other constabularies presented any evidence that the being seen route works, or is it just being thrown out?
No more impactful than the evidence from all the other Speedwatch teams that can show that their repeat offender list is going down and down and down. So, I mean, again, if you argue for that approach, their data suggests that, yeah.
it's working.
Oh, there's somebody in the room that's been involved since the very start, 5 years ago. You've taken input from other people in the room, like John Carter and Peter and Ken. If you want to be fully informed to make a decision, I'm very happy to give more of the background and more of the detail right up to this week.
Anybody want to hear that? Or do you want to take it under consideration?
Yes. Can that not be for a different time? There's nothing to vote on at the moment because this is just an update. Can this not be an information collecting exercise?
If Maggie'd like to send information in, then we can circulate it and bring it to the next meeting.
Or a suggestion to bring in Mr. McCandless, who is the area coordinator, to the next meeting to make a presentation and answer questions.
Either would work, as I say. Those who don't need a yes or no now, I just wanted to kind of give. When you boil it all down, then I think yes, an update would be valuable, so you get at least that side of the argument.
Should we get the constabulary along as well, then?
Just get some balance.
Is there a point in having one side of the debate?
Yeah.
We've read the emails, so we kind of get the sense of how heated it's been.
Yeah. Yes. I'd say that's why I'm keen to. Totally chosen my words very carefully.
Yeah.
And I said, remove all the heat out of the difference in styles, the approach and personalities. Fundamentally, the strategy shift is away from capture and educate to deter and be more visible. Yeah. And maybe once we have some more information from Andy and Dave and from the constabulary, we can then make a decision whether we decide to support one.
Well, from what I've read, though, I'd be a bit worried about having the constable and Mr. McCandless here together, because what I've read has been going on, they would be at loggerheads of a meeting that you're trying to have a sensible discussion.
Absolutely, it's a fair point. I'm sure we could organise or arrange and agree on some ground rules for the debate we were going to have. Another way to extend the process even further, because you have to have them along with different sessions, wouldn't you?
I don't know whether there's a need for a debate.
No, I don't think so. Because you've got a very, very balanced.
Maybe you can stand really have told everybody involved how it's going to be, according to what you said this evening. And we have a run with it, which mainly the volunteers feel or coordinators feel they should or shouldn't be involved, which is only their judgment. Or we cancel Speed Watch and do what we can to help log whoever we think can be influenced. That's the decision.
Which is, I think, the part of what
there's not really,
and
there's
what I'm getting across is that there is an ongoing process by the Speedwatch coordinators and those that prefer to go on, perhaps slightly tweaked, but as is, to try and resolve the issues, but it just hasn't worked out.
But it's still ongoing.
But maybe if I still go back, if perhaps just I would have a word with Ian and Andy to get what they know, and then you can come back and work your own in your own mind out what you feel and report back next time, because there is a chunk of things.
Yeah.
There's a lot of activity going on at the moment to try and resolve this. There is a compromise on both sides. I think Councillor White's in a few emails from a while ago. He's not up to speed on it. That would be good to get Mr. Cundas along to give the current situation.
I've seen emails that the council have been circulated the last month.
Well, that's a month ago. It's been happening this week, so.
Because I was going to propose that we ditch Speech Watch in view of the quite interesting emails that had been circulated, and advise that Hilton didn't want to be involved in that type of debate, and that it would be looking to go in line with what the constabulary were proposing, and that if people wanted to volunteer to be under that scheme, they contacted the Parish Council. But if you'd like to have further debate on the matter, please do.
I think it's quite an important thing.
Certainly
I just
from
think
the emails
if
I
we
saw,
lose,
I
lose
think
it, it and if we don't get volunteers wanting to sign up to the new regime, then people to get back into their old habits, you know.
But the operation can't work anyway.
I think, for the sake of a month, to let me speak to
I think you should,
David,
yes.
Andy, Ian, have a word with the coordinator from the constabulary, come back with the very latest picture at the next meeting, then at that point I think we can make a decision, the council, whether we throw in with the as is situation and support them wholeheartedly to try and get back to what they felt was working very effectively. Or we say thank you but no thank you, and we're going to try and find some volunteers and go down the new strategy that Cambridge Constabulary is pursuing at this time. So I'll take that away as an action then.
So you'll also speak to, is it PC Street, Sergeant Street?
Chris, well, I'll speak to Chris Savage, but it's...
Savage has volunteered to speak.
It's Brian Bollins.
Chris Savage.
But yeah, I'll get the most current both sides of the debate, and then I'll present it back to you guys in advance. You've got something to read as a little summary, and then as we can take a vote on which way we want to go.
The Hilton volunteers are very keen to continue. We've spent 5 years in wet and dry to run this.
Andy, you just stop, you keep interrupting. Thank you.
I'm just trying to give the Parish Council some useful information.
The agenda is Play Park Architect. Is that you, Jim?
I was hoping this came under the tree.
Well, we did have a difficult meeting. It didn't quite come together. Yeah. But I think we came to the conclusion that one thing we could do whilst we're doing this round of tree work is to remove a few trees and get some more lights in there. Mm. So that's one of the items on the list here that we've just voted for was the play park, and that's to remove a selection of trees close by in order to get some light in there. So I've also been down there with Graham on a separate occasion, who's, as we know, spent a lot of time scrubbing those tiles and has an emotional attachment to the place now. So hopefully we can get some, shed a bit of light in there and make some difference. But personally, I feel we've still got a problem.
Yeah.
But let's do this anyway and see.
I suppose the other thing, and maybe this is for the next 5% period, I don't know, but we get thought about maybe replacing those tiles with bark chips or something along those lines that would be easier to top up, replace, rather than the algae that you have to then remove with the fungicidal agent and the scrubbing and all the rest of it, and then it gets slick 5 minutes later. So,
I think one of the things that came up initially was the bark chip in wood concealed glass, and that was one of the problems. But
yeah,
and that is something that would have to be considered.
True.
But we need to keep an open mind.
It's a swing and a roundabout then, isn't it, really? You get fall and have a hair through you step and put a glass.
Yeah.
Or evil.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking, adding two and two, that having all this tree work, you have plenty of chippings potentially.
True, in fact, this is a slight tangent, it's kind of one thing. Yeah. When we were walking back from the bonfire today, we talked about getting more of the Hilton youth involved.
Yeah,
and again, if a certain demographic has an interest in keeping that park very much alive and active and in good shape, then perhaps some of those families can be encouraged and have one of those kind of clean-up days and get as many volunteers down as possible. So Billy Graham has another couple of able souls on hands and knees scrubbing away furiously. You might have 20 people turn up.
I'm sure Graham would like that, would he?
he can be persuaded to the most scrubbing brush for the moment.
He's very territorial.
No, I think that's a good idea. If people feel some ownership of the thing, then
we'll look after it. Otherwise, it's back to putting a padlock on the chain on the thing. Just say it's closed.
I'm going to put a caution notice up just to make people aware that, just to be a bit more
careful. It'd be very slippery.
We'll see whether the tree thing has a desired effect on less leaves.
I think it's going to help, but I don't think it's the whole
thing. All you do is get the sunshine on there, super rather, but you still get some leaves on there, won't you?
You'll get leaves. The sunshine will stop the algae forming.
Well, you get enough sunshine that will kill off the algae.
But the problem is, we won't be able to, especially in the winter months.
Yes.
Unless you remove all the trees.
Yeah.
And invoke the sun.
Yeah.
Just a thought that's coming through my head. The trees concerned are in the conservation land.
All the trees are in the conservation land, pretty much. And in the past, what's happened is we've sent a note to the conservation tree officer. Basically said what we're doing, listing the trees and the work. So we'll send that schedule of work.
Thank you. We've just popped up then. Okay, so the play park is open at the moment and we'll have a cautionary notice put on it. Item 3.7, bench outside the office chapel. You're going to give us an update, please.
Very happy to say that the bench is now repaired and spruced up, and if all goes to plan, it will be reinstated on the 8th, Saturday.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And that's at no cost to the parish council. That concludes item 3 of the agenda. Item 4 is committee working groups and members' items, which is the report from the Finance and General Purposes Committee regarding precept and budget, because it's that time of year again. So we had a Finance and General Purposes Committee meeting in October, and it was discussing how we should approach the precept for the coming year. So there's no firm decision or suggestions or recommendations to come forward to this meeting on this occasion. What the committee were looking at was, do we just tinker with the precept and say, oh, well, there's a little bit of inflation cost or non-inflation cost, there's a transit digits, or do we actually do a detailed piece of work that says, this is Hilton, this is what it takes to run Hilton, and see where that comes out in relation to the existing level of precept, and allow for contingencies for work like a falling tree across the pond on the crossroads, or trees falling into any of the other ponds down the way. So that is what the group is, or the committee is working on to present at the next Parish Council meeting, I believe. It's going to have another meeting close to the Parish Council meeting. It has set up a working group to be able to discuss that sort of thing. And then I'll have a meeting, and then it will bring its recommendations with regards to precept to the next meeting.
No, I think that the only thing I'd add is, in recent years, the deposit funds of council have been quite substantial. And we use in a number of different ways, paths, and when the crossing, was first discussed and envisaged at a likely cost of up to £10,000, everyone assumed it would be funded from those reserves. The reserves now are much diminished. They're still there, and they're still, plenty of money in the bank, but they are, compared with where they were 3 years ago, for example, much diminished. So I think that it's a good time to just, rather than going, well, a moderate 2% or whatever it may be on last year's budget, let's stop and look at everything in detail, do a proper job, ground up, so that we may end up at the same number.
Yeah.
But we may end up with a lower number or a higher number, and there are certain areas that we are arguably not covering particularly well. Play parks being mentioned, pavilions regularly mentioned, things that have not been really maintained at all.
It's been in recent years
that are probably going to do some work. We aren't going to put them all in one year, but we ought not to miss many. So that's
so you can kind of remix different versions to say, if we attended to this, what would the impact be?
Yeah. I think the work's still being done, so I think what Peter said is true, which I doubt we'll just turn up and deliver an option, but hopefully we'll come back with a discussion and a recommendation, but there'll definitely be some things we could put in or not put in, but we should have that debate.
No, I like that. I don't think we should be afraid of doing a good piece of work and analysis and ask for more, because there's always that fear factor. If you ask for more than 2%, well, you're penalised, which I think is nonsense, really. I think if it's well supported and it's thought through and there's a plan, as you say, you didn't mix and match elements over a 3-year period or something, then I think that can't be anything but well received. Whether you get all the money doesn't matter, but you won't be discounted out of hand because it's not appropriate to know.
If you don't get the money, at least you know what we're losing. And it allows you us to build in some contingencies, which I think is wise, considering how much asset we have to look after.
It's interesting that HDC are moving to zero-based budgeting on some of their functions. In a sense, we're saying the same thing.
So,
Look at it. Yeah, so maybe it is time to just say, right, these are the essentials that we have in Hilton. That's what they cost. That's where they're likely to go in terms of cost. And if you want to talk about doing a bit of maintenance on the pavilion, there isn't any. There's nothing in the budget that allows for that.
Well, maybe we could link it with Justin's idea about areas where we might be able to elicit either voluntary help or donations or something, which has the benefit of involving the village. I mean, it wouldn't work in every case, but that might be something to think about as well.
Yeah. We're taking it all in and we will...
We've already done a bit of that with the green spaces. We've got the smallest of volunteers, and I've noticed that the pathway leading from Churchley's estate to the shop has been well maintained. And in fact, it's all mown, nice and ready for winter. Mm-hmm. And another chap does a huge hedge, massive hedge.
Okay.
And he's a volunteer, so they are around and they're willing to do.
So that's what we need to look at.
Finance.
But we're going to have it. We will set it up.
It was a week before.
Yeah.
The Parish Council is the one.
And I'd also like you to consider if there is an emergency that we've got access to funds, you know, to give people cups of tea and blankets and whatever if needed.
We don't hold a float.
No, we don't. No. So, you know, I don't want to be straddling around. Who's got a pint of milk to make people hot cups of sweet tea because they're in shock. No, you know what I'm saying.
I do. I know exactly what you're saying.
Come forward with everything, but it's just got to add it to a little list.
How would we do it?
I don't know. Just give me carte blanche and a credit card. Nothing's your soul. That won't cost you any money, will it?
Joe's got a car.
Sorry, Heidi's taken it already. Yes. Immediate for his receipts and reimbursement. Mm, but yeah. But to know it's there to be able to do. So that's where we are with the precept and budget, and we will be coming back to you. Item 5, which is to look at the two agenda items, which is Balfour Beatty and Balfour Beatty.
Nothing to report on either, I'm afraid. Well, the invoice, I haven't received an updated invoice for the removal of the streetlight on the house in the Grove.
But they have acknowledged.
They've acknowledged that it was incorrect and it will be reduced. But I haven't had definitely the road closure. And the street lighting contract, after receiving the contract that they said asking us if we wanted to sign up for 3 years, I discovered our previous contract was a 3-year contract which doesn't run out until next year. So I've highlighted that to Balfour Beatty and they've asked me to send a copy of our current contract because I've sent a copy to them.
Yeah, we also looked in the finance and general purposes meeting at both contracts, the current one we have and the one that they were proposing, and with Parish, very little difference between them. So there didn't appear to be any particularly compelling reason to terminate our current contract early if that were being offered, but they're clearly confused.
Yeah. But I think it's just, they seem to have a lot of staff changes, don't they? Yeah.
Well, they're in trouble, aren't they? If you read the press, staff or BT, and Ian said they're a nightmare to deal with.
But they've got a 5-year contract to do with lights across Cambridgeshire. So we can honour that. They didn't do the, they weren't the guided bus people.
No, that was not all.
So, yes, we look forward to receiving updates when they come. Item 6, which is consider and decide any finance and risk. So, authorised payment to pay bills, Joe's circulated to do so. As Justo says, the first item on this is Joe's salary and her allowance of working from home, which was agreed with her on an annual basis, and a £3.72 postage, which makes it £538.78 for Joe. £6 to SLCC for postage vehicles.
Yeah, I didn't realise there was a postage charge, unfortunately. There is.
But that's still the discount you got on the books. Was, yeah. And then John's £575 standing order. And then work on the Wear and on Reeves Ditches, which came to 180. Rodney's final, probably final, grass cutting of the green.
Depending on the weather.
Yes. Well, I suppose, yes, given it was so mild last week. Eon electricity estimate and credit.
Yeah, we're on credit last week.
Fantastic. Although these are estimates, so to get reading.
Bernie's handyman check for September, October. Hertfordshire County Council print department with the flyers and maps for the A14 exhibition was £101, which was very reasonable. Very reasonable given the size of the colour printing. And then Cambridgeshire County Council street lighting energy charges, which was then that 906. Last Tuesday.
Yeah.
Including that? No, that, because they're accounting.
Yeah.
So that is the energy charges for the 1st of October 2013 to the 30th of September 2014.
Yeah, I was just going to say they used to
do half. The, half.
Yeah, yeah, but it's billed annually now, so it was only on and on.
Yes.
That's for street lights, whereas the EON is for the pavilion.
Yeah, sorry, EON is the pavilion. From the cricket pavilion. Any queries?
No.
Happy with I propose that we pay those accounts.
Seconded.
Okay, all those in favour?
One abstention.
Item 6.2, money's received. I can see it staring. Sorry. We have UK Power's easement check of £5.
That's good.
Thank you very much.
And we obviously have the fireworks.
We'll have the fireworks. I need to pay £1,613.55. So, I'm glad that checks in. I was getting a little worried. And that relates to, does it say? Just says, park farm, set access and cable. For an easement going across Park Farm.
I should get that, shouldn't
I? Don't think so.
£5
a year. Right, item 7 is council's items only, information only, no discussion, no decisions can be made.
On the deed for Brewer for the village that you mentioned in passing, so I'd like us to discuss. I saw one in a village on Saturday. And they actually had it attached to the church wall. The big signpost going, it's here. So very good. And you don't need to be trained, you think.
Okay, thank you. Kira.
No.
Nothing. Just there. Nothing. Thank you. Stephen?
I would like to say a few words, if that's okay. Brief statement. As a result of some comments I made at the meeting last month, the parishioner that I criticised, without naming, has written to the council asking that I make a public apology. Well, I would like to apologise not for the comments I made, but the fact that I'm not sure that I made my point as clearly as I would like. My family and I will be moving out of Hilton this week, and therefore I'll be resigning from Parish Council in the coming days. This will therefore be my last meeting. Over the last 2 years that I've been a part of it, I greatly enjoyed working alongside my fellow councillors, past and present. They're a dedicated bunch, you all and them, who undertake a great deal more work than most in this village would realise, giving their time without any reward. I will leave the council feeling very positive about the strength and the diversity of this group and its ability to manage and improve key aspects of life in Hilton. However, I have to admit that I'm disappointed that as I leave, a negative, counterproductive and time-consuming influence is still dogging the council. There is a very small minority within this village that has fought against and continues to fight against more of the council's processes, activities and initiatives than I can count. This highly vocal and frequently antagonistic minority has brought about the resignation of two chairs, two clerks and a good number of other councillors in just 2.5 years. I've been on the council for 1 year and 11 months, and I'm the longest serving councillor on this council. By a couple of minutes, Justin.
Good sight.
Good people who have better things to do with their time than to deal with the constant attrition, and who never imagined that being part of Hilton's Parish Council would be so fraught and stressful. And if you think I'm overstating the situation, just go and ask some of them. Furthermore, the almost constant influx of correspondence consumes a great deal of our clerks and chairman's time, which inevitably means they have less time to devote to other matters that are important to the village. There appears to be no purpose to the relentless criticism and challenge that this minority delivers, other than to undermine this democratically elected group, or perhaps to gain a disproportionate level of influence over it. This situation has prevailed for too long. Too much time and energy and emotion has been wasted. For the good of the village that I've loved living in for the past 6 years, I sincerely hope that this minority will rethink its approach and in the future turn its impressive energy to supporting and helping the council rather than obstructing it. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. On behalf of the Parish Council, I'd like to thank you for your time, effort, help, guidance, steerance. In the short time I've been on the Parish Council, it will be with regret that we receive your letter of resignation. Thank you very much for your time, efforts and help. And wish you all the best for the future in your environment.
Thank you.
Thank you, Steve.
Gosh, I didn't know you were going.
And then that point eight is closure. Thank you all for coming.